Hello students, this is Matthew sir from Arya Gurukul group tuitions. I hope my previous videos and audios was useful to you in getting an idea about the entire portion. We are going to learn this year various chapters which I have already informed to you. Today I would like to revise the first chapter which we started, which I have already taught to you, all those topics we will revise, and I hope you have not forgotten it as it is almost a month. So students, we started with the first chapter and the name of that chapter was Rise of Nationalism. You can see the cover page of the textbook which we are going to use the entire year. So let us go down to the first slide. First slide talks about Frederick Soray, four print. Now when we talk about Frederick Soray's four print, I had given you already the notes for it, but let us revise once again the four prints of Frederick Soray. The first print shows that people from Europe and America are marching in a long train and offering homage to the Statue of Liberty. There are a lot of shortcuts which I use. I hope that while looking at the screen, you might have recollected whatever we have done. So first print, once again, people of Europe and America, they are marching like a long train and paying homage to the Statue of Liberty. What is the Statue of Liberty? It is a female figure which is carrying a torch of liberty in her hand. You can see the figure is next to you, torch of enlightenment in one hand, and in the other hand you got the Charter of Rights of Men. So female allegory, a female figure. So that is what first print is connected with. In the second print, we can see on the earth there are some shattered remains of the symbols of absolutic institutions. That means those kings or those rulers, shattered remains have been put. That indicates that the people would like to destroy the monarchy and establish their democratic institution. Now remember, this is Frederick Soray's visualization which he has done, who is a French artist, and he has done this in 1848. He has visualized and dreamed the world as the world is made up of democratic and social republics. The third print is an utopian vision which Soray thinks, and the people of the world are grouped here, he imagines, as a distinct nations, and he has identified them through their flags and national costumes. You can see people wearing different costumes and having different flag, and this indicates that these are the different, and you can see the line of people, you know, they are grouped together, so they indicate democratic nations which are formed. So initially the world was under the dominion of monarchy, but now if you can see, the people have decided that they would like to liberate themselves, and so they are taking the flag and they are moving towards the Statue of Liberty. The fourth print here indicates from the heaven Christ, saints and angels, they are gazing at this scene. When they are gazing at this thing, they are looking all the human beings as their children, and the artist here is trying to symbolize fraternity among the nations of the world. That means all the human beings, the children of God, and they are all moving together. That means they exhibit fraternity, that is brotherhood among themselves. So these are the four prints. if you see, there are the different groups of people coming together. You can see that there are different countries like USA, Switzerland. They are the one was initially reached. Followed by them is France and Germany. Following Germany is Austria, then the kingdom of two Sicilies, Lombardy, Poland, England, Ireland, Hungary and Russia, and so on. The flags indicates that the marching people are the people from these countries. So this is Frederick Soray's four prints. Now let us move on to the next slide. Here we have learned the concept of nation states. When you talk about the nation states, there are two nation type of nation states. Today what we are going to live, today in which states we are living is called as the modern states. When we talk about modern states, it is nothing but the state which has got a centralized power, and centralized power exercised sovereign control over a defined territory. So centralized power, like we have got our parliament, which is a centralized power which is having a sovereign control over a defined territory. That is what is a modern state. So today all the countries, they are modern states. But here we are learning the concept of nation states, wherein the majority of the people, who are nothing but the citizens, they develop a common identity and shared history or descent. So when we talk about common identity or shared history and student, it has got certain meaning. Here the common identity can be of language, culture, tradition, etc. Or when people from different community or religion, when they come together, we call it as a shared, on a shared platform. There can be sharing of language, religion, culture, or any set of values, symbols, folklore, etc. When people come down with this type of shared history or descent, we call that as a nation state. Now, there is a question that what is this commonness? What are the reasons for this commonness? The reason for this commonness can be due to some forced struggles which the people might have undertaken, or maybe through the action of leaders and the common people. So this is what is the definition we have to understand for the concept of nation states. So concept of nation states, the points are given to you. First point here is the reason for the what is a modern state, and then going to nation state with majority of its citizens, which develops a sense of common identity or shared identity or descent. And then the reason for it, the commonness, is because of the forced struggles, the action of the leaders and the common people. So all the main points have been put to given to you before also, and I hope you might have learned this concept of nation states. So if there is a question asked that explain modern state, then you have to give the above answer. And if there is a question asked to define the concept of nation states along with the modern state, you can explain the nation states in a proper sentences. All this is in a short form. You have to write it as a notes, practice it again and again. I hope that by practicing you can learn those answers permanently. Okay students, now let us go down to the next slide. That is, what is nation according to Ernest Renan? You can see the photograph of Ernest Renan on the right hand side of your screen. Ernest Renan was a French philosopher, and the date also I had mentioned, that is from 1832 to 1892. So he was born in 1832 and he died in the year 1892. According to Ernest Renan, what is the concept of a nation? He has mentioned that nation is a culmination, meaning formation, of a long past of ESD, meaning is endeavor, sacrifice and devotions. And who has made this sacrifice, devotions and endeavor? It is a people. So it is a culmination, it's a formation. State is formed because of the sacrifice and the devotions of the people, the endeavor of the people, that they want to become something in their life. That gives rise to formation of a nation. So national idea is basically based on three things. Either there could be a heroic past, there can be a great men who are responsible for this national idea, or the glory of the past. All these things can lead to the idea of a nation. A heroic past, we already know that during the freedom struggle also, you have seen that lot of heroic deed been done by some revolutionaries, great men like Shivaji Maharaj, and the glory of the past like Chandragupta Maurya or Ashoka the Great. All these things inspire people to be under one banner, which we call it as a nation. Now, what is essential for formation of a nation? First of all, to be the people of the state, that is a citizen, they should have common glories of the past. So these are the essential condition I am talking, that they should have a common glories of the past. They should have a common will in the present, or they should perform great deeds together, or they should have a wish to perform these great deeds still more. These are the essential conditions for being a people. So what are the essential conditions to being the people of the state? You know, the people of the state should also have these qualities. They should have these qualities to form a nation. And what are the qualities they should have? The qualities they should have is, the people should have common glories in the past, common will in the present, to perform great deeds, and the wish to perform still more greater deeds. These are the qualities people should have, so that they can be called as the citizens of the nation. Try to understand this. First, we have seen how the nation is formed with ESD. Second, how a national idea can be formed. And now, what is a nation made up of? It is made up of people. And what qualities people should also have, so that they can come under one nation. Thus, we can sum up everything and you can tell that a nation is nothing but a large-scale solidarity and whose existence depend upon daily plebiscite, that is daily approval of the people, or a daily vote of approval of the people, either to accept or to reject a proposal, that is called as plebiscite. So, large-scale solidarity means unity, and that will depend upon the daily plebiscite, that is the daily approval, the daily acceptance, daily rejection which is made by the people. So that is something which will form a nation. We can see today, if you see the today's scenario, we can see as a country how we are all together. When we are fighting coronavirus, we are seeing that people are showing large-scale solidarity. and everybody is approving whatever the government is telling. So that basically gives rise to formation of a nation. So today is the best example for us to understand how a nation can be formed. If the people rejects everything, then we cannot tell that we are citizens of the nation. Citizens of the nation is one who agrees, who accepts everything together, and if you want to reject, rejects everything together. Next point is, a nation never has any real interest. If the nation is a true nation, it will never have a real interest in annexing or holding any other nation, and that too against their will. A nation which is formed will continue to remain as a nation and try to do good things for their own people, not for capturing other country, annexing them, holding them against their will. That is not the true form of a nation. The existence of a nation is a guarantee of liberty, which would be lost if the world had only one law and one master. If the world has one law and one master, can we tell that liberty exists? He will behave, he will live, he will rule us in any way he wants. So that is not the correct way. So for the nation, liberty is very, very important. For the nation to be a true nation, never it should annex or hold any other country against their will. As a nation, should have a daily plebiscite or should have a large-scale solidarity. So all these points basically are highlighting what is a nation. I want you to learn this and write it without any support from the textbook on your own. Understand it properly and write it. Let us go down to the next point. How did the French Revolution influence the people of Europe? We can see from the very beginning of the French Revolution, revolutionaries, they have introduced various measures and practices that could create a sense of collective identity among the French people. So what is that collective identity is been given here? The first is the idea of la patrie, is fatherland, la citoyen, that is citizen, which emphasized the notion of united community enjoying equal rights under a constitution. A new French flag, that is a tricolor flag, was chosen to replace the formal royal standard. Estate generals which was a body of active citizens, were renamed as national assemblies. This already you have learned in 9th standard. New hymns were composed, oaths were taken, martyrs were commemorated in the name of nation. A centralized administrative system was put in place and formulated uniform laws for the citizen within the territories. Internal custom duties and dues were abolished, and a uniform system of weight and measures were adopted. Regional dialects were encouraged, and French, as it was spoken and written in Paris, became the common language. French language became the common language. All other languages were, regional dialects were discouraged. So these are something what French Revolution has done to influence the people of Europe. So all these things we have to understand, okay, what is the meaning behind all these things. So students, let us understand what is French Revolution wants to tell us to the world. Here they are trying to bring a bond between the people of singleness. That means they are trying to develop a nationalism in the people. How they try to develop that nationalism? By emphasizing on single things to be followed by all the people. In India we have got different states with different languages, different culture, tradition, religion, but we all follow one constitution. That is that will keep us united. So this is what French Revolution has taught the people, that they have to remain united. And for that, we already see that French people have already done many things. They have discovered these ideas of La Patria, La Citoyenne. They have found out a flag of their own. We have seen the Estates General been renamed as National Assembly. We have seen new IMS, centralized administrative systems, internal custom duties and dues were abolished with uniform system of weight and measures, all regional dialects discouraged. I have already talked to you. So all these things basically drive us to one thing, that the oneness or the collective identity, okay, should be made in such a manner that people should feel in themselves that they are from one nation. That is, we also feel wherever people from, you know, different states, they will not call themselves by their state, but they will call themselves with the help of, with the nation, because we are all born together with one nation. Further, if I want to add a few points in this same question, the Estates General, as we already know, that they were elected and they were called, Estates Generals were renamed as National Assemblies, which is a body of active citizens. They further declared that it was a mission and the destiny of the French nation to liberate the people of Europe from despotism and help them to become nation. So France doesn't stop here with all those unique things which it did for nationalism or to develop nationalism in their country. It didn't stop there, but France further declared that it is their mission and destiny to liberate the other peoples of Europe who were under the despotic rules of the monarch and they were suffering. So people of France fought their bitter battle to remove that despotism from their country, but they didn't stop there. Many nations, they get liberated and they stop. India, after liberation, helped the African countries to free themselves. So this is what is a true nation, true leader. And so France did the same thing for the people of Europe and they helped them to become nations, that is, to become a free nations. So I hope you understood this topic clearly. So purposely I put it in the question form so that you can understand this. Already we have already discussed and we have written it, but I think this will emphasize your learning much more better. Move on to the next slide. What are the major changes that occurred in the political and constitutional scenario due to the French Revolution in Europe? Now, first major change which came was the first clear expression of nationalism, which I am already talking. The first clear expression of nationalism came from the French Revolution. We already know French Revolution took place in 1789. So it was a clear expression of nationalism. Here you can see France became a full-fledged territorial state in the year 1789. Here you can also see there was transfer of sovereignty from monarchy. We already know that Louis XVI was ruling that time. So the sovereignty or the freedom of the people from the monarchy was taken and it was given to the body of French citizen. We already know it was initially called as Estate General and later on it was called as National Assembly. The revolution proclaimed, or it mentioned, that it was the people who would henceforward constitute the nation and shape its destiny. So students, you can understand how the importance of people was highlighted in the French Revolution. Initially it was the king who is to be considered as the head of the nation, and everything was to start from the king and end it to the king. But first time ever after the French Revolution, who got the importance here? The people got the importance. The French Revolution clearly states that the nation is constituted with the help of the people, and the destiny of the nation will also be designed or shaped by the people. So this is something which was a major change that occurred as a political and constitutional scenario due to the French Revolution in Europe. I hope you have understood this. Let us move on to the next slide. This is one of the most interesting question which we have learned, and this talks about the Napoleonic Civil Code. When we talk about Napoleonic Civil Code, let us try to understand about Napoleon as a person. Napoleon was a French military leader who afterwards became the emperor, and he conquered much of the Europe in the 19th century from 1789 to 1799. From the year 1789 to 1799, he worked through different routes in the military. That is how he went up in his life. And later in 1799, he did a military coup and he crushed himself. So 1789 he became, and the French Revolution took place, he was a military general. But in 10 years time he went to different ranks, and then with a military coup. Military coup is something we call it in Hindi as a sajish. In 1799 a military coup, and he crowned himself as the Emperor of France. We already know the incidents of Robespierre and all that was going that time. People were not happy, they were weary and tired of Robespierre and people like that who are coming and ruling France after Louis the 16th. So he was a shrewd, ambitious and a skilled military strategist. He waged a war against many European powers, but has two downfall in his life. One in 1812 when French attacked, when they got defeated because of Russia. He was abdicated from the throne. That time he was exiled to Elba. He returned to power in 100 days again. Then again the famous Battle of Waterloo with England. He was exiled again to St. Helena, where he died at the age of 51 years. So this was something, a brief about Napoleon, so that you get an understanding that how Napoleon, who was he and what was his a character sketch. So he was not, he was, we cannot tell him that he was a character which has got a bad shape. In fact, he was a person who has helped during the French Revolution. But his method of making the people good was not good for the people. His method was not correct. Then he employed some good methods. You can see Napoleonic Civil Code. But then his method was basically pressurizing the people to follow certain things. And you already know that whenever we are talking about nation, we are talking that people want liberty. So before going to the Napoleonic Civil Code, we have understood what is the true sketch of Napoleon, so that now we can understand his civil code also properly. So students, Napoleonic Civil Code, first point is, the Civil Code was made in the year 1804. Napoleonic Civil Code took away all the privileges based on birth. It established equality among the people. It secured the right to property, and it simplified the administrative divisions and abolished the feudal system. So if you see, all in all, good things were done by Napoleon. So no doubt he destroyed democracy in France, but in the administrative field you can see that he has brought a lot of good changes. So when we talk about Napoleonic Civil Code, there are some few points more we can add, is that in the towns, guild restrictions were removed. What are guilds? Guilds are basically those group of people who are artisans and they regulate the production of the goods. That means if you go into a village, there will be a group of people who will take care that how much production a blacksmith can be doing. So various artisans, they will have their own group and they will decide that how much. Like if you see in today's world, if you see the rickshawalas, they have a group and these rickshawala people, they will charge some amount of money, fixed amount of money only they will charge from moving from one destination to another. So like that, these guilds, they used to have their own decisions of how much production should be done or how much their people in a group should work. That all restrictions they were having. So in the towns, guild restrictions were removed. Now this will help the business basically. So business people, they were very happy because the guild restrictions were removed by Napoleonic Civil Code. Transport and communication system was improved because he started capturing all the nations of Europe, so the boundaries were dissolved. So transport communication system was like, you know, it was completely improved. Peasants, artisans, workers, new businessmen, they enjoyed this newfound freedom. They were very happy. So initially all positive points started coming up because of Napoleonic Civil Code. He introduced uniform laws, standardized weights and measures, common national currency to facilitate the movement and exchange of goods and the capitals from one place to another. So you can see on the right side, Napoleon himself and the Napoleonic Civil Code, the book which he made as a civil code, as a, you know, why we call it as a civil code? It is civil means people, common people, and code is nothing but a law which everybody has to follow. So this is what is Napoleonic Civil Code. If you want to write Napoleonic Civil Code, you have to write all these points as well as these points together. And that will, so try to practice, because this is an answer which comes as a brief answer. So you have to learn this properly. Now let us go down to the next question. How did the local people in the areas conquered by Napoleon reacted to the French rule? We already know that Napoleon is from France. And he did not limit the rule of his kingdom only up to France. But he took it beyond France and he captured a lot of areas in Europe. So initially the reaction of the local population were good and some people were telling it is not good. So there was a mixed type of reaction we can see in the local population. Many places initially, the French armies were welcomed as the harbingers of liberty. Now here you have to understand the scenario. France has been liberated, but what about other people around Europe? They are not liberated. They were under the monarchy. They were suffering. So they thought if the French army will come, they will also get freedom. Like the French people have got the freedom from their monarch. So they started welcoming the Napoleon's army as the harbingers of liberty. New administration of Napoleon, it did not go hand in hand with the political freedom. People got freedom, but they were forced with some type of new administration, the Napoleonic Civil Code. The enthusiasm of the people turned into hostility. Initially they liked, then they started reverting. They started, you know, going away. There was increased taxation. There was censorship, there was forced conscriptions into the French armies. Conscriptions, people were forced and pushed into the French armies so that they can conquer the rest of the Europe. This all things people did not like, and it outweighed the advantages of the administrative changes made by Napoleon. Now Napoleon did it for the good of the people, but people did not understand. The reason is everybody wants liberty. Today we are all packed into one home. See what is our condition. We start blaming the government. Why they did not took the step before? They have forced us here. Slowly, the more the amount people will be pushed in, the more the people will start telling. similar type of conditions were existing that time. So whatever Napoleon was doing was considered to be as a force and things. So let us move on to the next slide. My next slide is something which is a homework for you. What was the mission of French Revolution? That is what you have to find it out from the textbook. We have already done all these things. So it is very easy for you to find out. These are all small, small questions. 1790, French army is moved into which countries? Names of the countries has to be written. You can get the names of the countries on page number 7. You can get it on the page number 7. You can get it. Many names are there. Okay, so you can write Holland, Switzerland, Brussels, Mainz, Milan, Warsaw. That's how they were welcomed as harbingers of liberty. Now let us go on to the next question, that how did a revolutionary idea spread to other countries? Yes. How did they spread into other countries? Answers are also available in the textbook. How did it spread? You have to find it out, all these answers. If you have any queries, you can. Okay. So just look into the textbooks, read it again, because all these points have already done it. So that's why these questions have come down. You have to make an attempt to read the textbook again and again. In which country the French army was welcomed as harbingers of liberty? Here again. Okay. So you can write those names. There is followed by that you have got how were the French armies welcomed. Okay, the answer is also available there. Okay, how they were welcomed as the harbingers of liberty. Okay, so all these questions I have given it, maybe answers are already there. Some answers are already given to you backside, some answers from there only you have to write it here. So make an attempt to write it, but all those important questions which I have given to you initially, I have also mentioned all the points and all that. I suppose that will be easier for you more. Okay. So this was, I suppose, the last slide for so today what we did, in short, we started, you can see, we started with our rise of nationalism. And then we moved on to the Frederick Soray Four Prints, concept of nation states, okay, where you understood what is a nation state, or the difference between nation state and modern state. You've seen Ernest Renan's, what his concept of nation is belongs to, and it was very clearly explained that what is a nation. You've seen French Revolution influence. You also seen the changes in the political scenario, Napoleonic Civil Code we have seen. Napoleonic Civil Code, two slides are there, please do it again and again properly. You've seen how local people in the areas conquered, what was the reaction of these people to the Napoleonic rule. So, and the homework part is also very, very important. So I suppose that whatever has been taught to you, you will follow it and you will do it. We will meet next time. We will continue the chapter further. I also would like to take up start up geography simultaneously, so that you got two things, but keep practicing the maps of geography. Thank you.